66 cars showed up to race their way into the Smash Beer Get Smash 200, but first they had to go through qualifying, and starting on the pole for the Smash Beer Get Smash 200 will be Stanley Parsons in car number 427. For Wesley Family Racing, Leslie Riggs in the number 9 for Motor Assault Racing will start on the outside of the front row. Those two will be guaranteed to start the 200, as well as Thomas Tucker, the winner of the Rookie Shootout. Everyone else is not safe, and they have to race their way in through the Lobo Twin 100s. Here's how it works. After qualifying, the field is split into two races of 100 miles, 40 laps around here at Daytona, based on their qualifying times. The odd positions will start in race one, and they will be racing for the inside line to start the Smash Beer Get Smash 200. Race two will be made up of the even positions, and they will be racing for the outside line of the 200. The top 20 from each race will transfer to the 200, but this is assuming that the drivers guaranteed in finish in the top 20. If Stanley Parsons or Leslie Riggs finish outside the top 20 in their respective races, then the top 19 will transfer and 20th place will be bumped out in favor of them. But if Thomas Tucker, who is guaranteed in through his victory in the Rookie Shootout, fails to finish in the top 20, he will get into the race anyway, and 41 cars will start instead of 40. Stanley Parsons and Leslie Riggs will receive 20 bonus points each for starting on the pole in their respective races, and Parsons will receive 20 more once he starts on the pole for the Smash Beer Get Smashed 200. Parsons and Riggs will also have to finish the race in order to keep their front row starting spots. Now let's have a look at race number one. The pace car leaves the field in the hands of Stanley Parsons, but you already see trouble in the back. Patrick Carpino has a flat tire he will take to the pit lane and miss the start. Parsons, starting on the pole for the Smash Beer Get Smash 200 tomorrow, does not get a great start. Here comes Bob Steffens, jumping to the inside. Steffens is going to grab the early lead. Bob Steffens finished third in the championship last year behind Rip Tyler and Ryan Matthews. He did very, very well without a race win. And Steffens leads the first lap. He gets 5 bonus points, already trying to get a good jump on this season. Now, for quite a few years, FARC did not hand out bonus points for leading a lap. They used to do it, then stopped doing it for a few seasons, and now they brought it back for 2016. Coming to the end of lap one, Mike Malone has to drop out of the race with a mechanical problem. Heartbreaking for Mike Malone, who probably makes the longest trek to get to these races out of anybody else. His team is based out of Los Angeles. So all that effort to get to the track and go through qualifying just for a 33rd place finish. Jack Ashcroft is struggling, falling through the field and hitting the wall after starting on the outside of the front row. Near disaster between Farrell Burgundy and Danica Hollifield. They got together. This racing up in this lead group is very, very tight. Zidane Quackenbush almost turned car number 4 around. Patrick Carpino is back on the track after getting that flat tire before the green flag. He's about 2/3 of a lap behind, so Carpino is going to need a caution to get back up there. And that might come very soon if the field keeps racing the way they are, 3-4 wide. Most of the FARC field is made up of short trackers who aren't very experienced at racing at these super speedways, running up in these tight groups. So, oh boy, things are getting very interesting very early here at Daytona. Stanley Parsons getting squeezed in with Zach Denman in that 102, that green car on the inside there. And Kenny Brillen, that bright yellow 20. That yellow car up at the front is Danica Hollifield, the race leader. I'm sure she's relieved that she's running out there by herself and not in this tight group. Zach Denman feels the consequences of this tight racing, getting shoved up into the wall after Todd Stater made contact with Winston Orwell. And now Orwell's going to get into the back of Chuck Johnson. Johnson and Naomi Alonco go spinning right in front of the field, and more cars are coming as they slide back down. Todd Lacey gets into the back of the 46. Here come more cars getting involved. Dale Underwood, Ronnie Holter, and Kirby Krieger in that 76 car. These cars all fell behind at the start. We're coming up on the wreck. They took to the apron, but that was the wrong place to go. And some of these guys were teams that really do not need destroyed race cars. Ronnie Holter with Team Burr and Kirby Krieger with the AJ Young team. Jim Kidd, Zdane Quackenbush, and Stan Coleman do not pit under this first Vicker collision and glass caution, which fell on lap number 7. These guys that all pitted, they're going to need to pit again later in the race. It's only a 40-lap race. You can make that distance with one pit stop. So these top four decide it wasn't worth it to pit under this caution and opt for track position. Trek Togger in that 74 also did not pit. But Jim Kidd's track position is in danger. He did not get a very good start. Quackenbush takes the lead. Stan Coleman falls through to second. And that might be why Jim Kidd did not get going. He had a problem under the hood, and now the smoke is spewing out the back of that car. Oh, near disaster. Stanley Parsons has to check up as Kidd enters the pit lane. Jim Kidd returning to FARC with the championship-winning Sergio Power team. But unfortunately, they're not off to a very good start. Winston Orwell cuts a tire. Another one of the LaCoya-powered cars. Orwell's going to have to hit the pit lane after this restart, but obviously, unlike Jim Kidd, Orwell's going to be able to get back onto the track. He's going to lose a lap, though. In the meantime, Greg Gray takes over the race lead. That's a familiar sight. The Ken Groves Racing, number 78, running at the front of the field at Daytona. After all, they did win this race, the season opener, twice in a row when the opener was held at Daytona with Manuel Ortiz and Master Cup car owner Marcus Leonard. So Greg Gray is in very good hands when it comes to Daytona. Greg Gray, the short tracker from the East Coast, his father Terry Gray owns a number of Griesberger franchises up in the East Coast. And of course, Griesberger has been a longtime supporter of FARC Racing, so it's always nice to see that familiar red burger silhouette coming back. Trouble for Stan Coleman. He blows an engine. Look out! Stanley Parsons taking to the apron. Not sure where the 40 car was going. Stan Coleman started up at the front of the field on the restart. He did not pit. He had been slowly falling through the lead group, but I don't believe he was going as slowly as these cars right here. Troy Peterson, some kind of wiggle from the double zero. He had a really check up entering turn one, but it looks like he's back up to speed. No other issues there. Troy Peterson running in 20th place, the final transfer spot for the Smash Beer Get Smash 200. And as I was saying about Stan Coleman, I don't believe was running as slowly as these guys, so even with him falling through the field, he probably would have been safely in. Here's the first of the odd men out, AJ Young. He is very far behind that battle for 20th place. So those guys are not under immediate threat from AJ Young. You saw Winston Orwell go by much, much faster than the 26, but Orwell is a lap down. So Winston Orwell, after getting that flat tire, still has a lot of work to do. That, or he's going to need some more people to fall out ahead of him. Here is the lead group, not nearly as crazy as it was at the beginning of the race. Kenny Brillen going for the lead against Monica Roque. You saw Zdane Quackenbush coming out of the pits. That is a scheduled stop. Remember, he did not pit under that caution, so he's going to have to pit much, much earlier than these guys. And there's Zach Denman missing the front end of his 102 car. The leaders split him down the middle. No one gets held up by the 102, fortunately. Here is the first active battle for position behind the leaders. Aaron Singer leading Allie Riggs. Aaron Singer, the only M&J car in this race. All three of his teammates are in race number 2. Allie Riggs trying to get by the 62 car as they come up on Bob Steffens, who fell behind when he was held up by the 18 of Jim Kidd pitting. The leaders come to lap AJ Young, Anthony Griffith, and Lev Azarov get held up behind the 26. They scoot around him. Hopefully they will not lose the draft. Coming to 12 laps to go, Monica Roque gives up the lead to make her pit stop. AJ Young in the 26 is going to follow, but I don't think Monica Roque can count on AJ Young being a good drafting partner, being much, much faster than him. On the following lap, Kenny Brillen, Danica Hollifield, and Anthony Griffith pull in to make their pit stops, followed by another group of three. The lap after that, Greg Gray, Richard Scott, and Todd Stater in that 66. Liam O'Connor and Lev Azarov are the last two to pit. Here comes Lev Azarov, which is going to leave Liam O'Connor running around all by himself. He picks up the lead and 5 bonus points, but he's running alone out there. And without the draft, he is going to lose time against the guys who pitted in groups and will likely have drafting partners when they come back out. Liam O'Connor now pulls in, coming to 8 laps remaining. And after pit stop cycle out, Richard Scott is your leader. The 27 crew nailed their pit stop and got Scott out back ahead of Greg Gray, that's 78, and it's a long ways back to the rest of the leaders who have grouped up. Liam O'Connor and Anthony Griffith lead this group here, so pitting very late and by himself was not such a big disaster as expected for Liam O'Connor. But as quick as those stops were for Richard Scott and Greg Gray, they are at a disadvantage running out ahead of this group. But we've only got 4 laps to go. It'll be 3 to go next time by. So will they have built up enough of a buffer to hold off this group? Greg Gray hasn't. He gets swallowed up. And the battle for second place is on between Danica Hollifield and Anthony Griffith. But Richard Scott is still out ahead with 2 laps to go. Scott, out of 4, is going to take the white flag. Richard Scott, 2 weeks ago, did not know if he would be entering this race. He's been busy with his TM Master Cup and TM Lights commitments. That's why he left FARC after the 2014 season in the first place to focus on those efforts. But Gibson Speedy Lube stepped up at the last minute and helped Scott and his father get a car together for this race. And now Richard Scott is looking at his first career win, but he's got to hold off a charging Liam O'Connor. O'Connor is right on Richard Scott's bumper as they enter turn 3. He's still coming, inching closer and closer. Scott leaves him room on the bottom, but O'Connor does not have the momentum. He tucks in behind the 27, and Richard Scott will take his first career FARC Smash Beer Low Dollar Series victory. And that's going to fulfill one of the biggest requirements for FARC Off eligibility. But this is the only race that Scott and his father planned on entering. But we will see if they succumb to temptation and try to enter more races. That is, if they don't also take the Smash Beer 200 tomorrow and guarantee themselves entry into the FARC Off. Remember, you can qualify for the FARC Off on 1 victory as long as you stay in the top 40 in driver points, but if you get 2 wins, you qualify regardless of your points position. Liam O'Connor comes home in 2nd place, Danica Hollifield 3rd, Greg Gray, another great result for Ken Groves Racing at Daytona, 4th place for him. He also gains 10 bonus points for leading the most laps, and it's Rook Griffith, Lecklider, Lev Azarov, Arus Autosport, Todd Stater, with the David Hetzel Racing Team, his new home. 9th place for Stater, Kenny Brillin 10th, Zdane Quackenbush 11th, 15 years old, he's the youngest driver in the field. Trek Togger 12th, Aaron Singer, the lone M&J car in this race. His 3 teammates will be in race number 2. Ali Riggs 14th, Patrick Carpino 15th, coming back after cutting his tire down before the green flag. Jack Ashcroft struggled to get up to speed, but salvages a 16th place finish. Stanley Parsons finishes 17th. He fell behind after getting held up by Jim Kidd cutting across the track, but he will still start on the pole for tomorrow's Smash Beer 200. Farrell Burgundy 18th. Troy Peterson for the Dale Clow team coming home 19th. And Bob Steffens rounds out the top 20. And he rounds out the drivers who will be transferring to the Smash Beer 200. Now let's have a look at race number 2. Leslie Riggs leads the field down to the green flag, back in a familiar black car. Riggs has driven black cars for most of her FARC racing career. She gets a pretty good start over Mark Thompson and Kevin Monroe. The M&J cars fall in line behind the 9. As the top 3 get away, it looks like the M&J cars might be trying something. Riggs leaves just a little bit of room on the inside for Mark Thompson to take a peek. Monroe follows in that new purple 63 car. Duke of Oil coming on board to sponsor the 63 team. And there goes Mark Thompson down to the inside. Thompson very eager to show what he can do in this new opportunity with M&J Racing. He fielded his own car in a few races last year and did very well considering what little money he had behind that operation. And Thompson will lead the first lap, shuffling Leslie Riggs back to third. Contact with Billy Bob Childers puts Rebel Denman up into the wall, but Bradley Carlisle spins trying to react to this. You also saw Kurt Walker in the 98 just squeeze by. If Walker had been just a few feet back, this would have ended in a huge disaster, but we've got a huge disaster in the works here. Five wide for the race lead. Coming back to the caution, Zach Gott gets up into the wall. So does Leslie Riggs. Fortunately, that's all that happens. Let's try to take it easy in these opening laps and not cause a bigger crash than what caused the caution in the first place. We're only working lap five. Now about half the field stayed out, half the field pitted. Zach Webster and James West lead the field back to the restart. Mark Thompson settling into third place as Webster paces the field down the back straightaway, mostly single file for now. But of course, this being Daytona, that's going to change as Kira Smith goes for the lead. James West, big wiggle from the 69, entering turn number one. Working lap number 15, West was one of the cars that didn't pit. Now, this track might look easy to drive on, but it does wear your tires away as you go on. And as the tires wear out on some of these cars, the drivers might struggle for handling. And West, as you just saw, almost let it get away from him. Back to three wide racing. Thomas Tucker gets into the back of Zach Webster off of turn number two. That could have been a disaster for Webster as he faces pressure from the winner of the rookie shootout. Now, Tucker didn't qualify very well. He started on the inside of row 13, but it's obviously Ashcroft Family Racing Team has been tuning their cars for long runs, and it's paying off as Tucker has found his way to the front of the field, and Tucker will take over the lead on lap number 17, adding to the bonus points that he already got for winning the rookie shootout. Now here's Tiffany Burch in the 422 for Green or Die Racing, running in 33rd in last place. All 33 cars that started are still running, but Burch is way behind. She seems to have lost something in that 422 car and has lost the field. She's gonna need a caution to help herself get back up there and let that team figure out what's going on. Now here's 20th place David Lamar in the second Stan Coleman car. After watching his team owner go out in the first race, I'm sure Lamar is nervous about his own engine. Thomas Tucker continues to lead the race as we pass the halfway point. Lap number 21, we're working now. And nobody has been able to try to mount a charge yet, just as we saw in the rookie shootout. The Ashcroft crew didn't touch that car between the rookie shootout and today's race. And why would they? It's working out perfectly for them. Second and third place, Kenny George and Max Chevillon were also in the rookie shootout. Looking now at Ashley Tucker, the older sister of Thomas Tucker, in her brand new ride at M&J Racing, the iconic number 64 car with E-Cola sponsorship. She'll be driving this car on the ovals, and Kevin Daly will be taking over that car on the road courses. Now, M&J is a familiar environment for Ashley Tucker. She drove for the Riggs team when that team was still around, and they had a strong technical alliance with M&J at the time. And then she went to Bjorn Green's team, but struggled during 2015. But now she's back in a top ride. Here are Kira Smith and Jason Bates, who have fallen behind the field, and Kira Smith spins out in turn one all by herself. Something happened with that 89 car, and here come more cars to join the party. Max Hollifield, the 777, Zach Gott, the 71, Mason St. Martin, the 204. Now what happened here? Oh, St. Martin spun out by himself as well. Maybe something broke on that 89 and she dropped oil all over the place. But I've seen very few people lose it when something breaks on their car. And one more car joining in the fun, Harv Henry, the 04. But as I was saying, when something breaks on one of these cars, usually the driver will catch it, but I understand that Kira Smith's been struggling to get a handle of these fart cars when she tested with Terra International Motorsports at a short track not too far from where their shop is based. Apparently, she tore up the car she was testing. Anyway, Ashley Tucker leads on the restart. The whole field pitted. She was the first car out. James West, last car on the lead lap. Big slide for Art Gordon coming out of turn four with a little bit of help from Rebel Denman, but this was way at the back of the field. So the caution doesn't come out. We keep racing, but Art Gordon is gonna fall way behind. In fact, he was running 12th, but now he's been knocked out of the transfer spot. But we get a caution as Kelly Splicing gets turned by Dan Leglider. Thomas Tucker gets swept up in it. But fortunately, they went spinning into the infield instead of back up in front of traffic. So they're going to be able to gather it up and get back going. Restart comes with 7 laps to go. Kenny George out in front. James West, the lapped car, in between himself and second place Mark Thompson. West is holding up the field for the 50. Letting him get away. I wonder, are we going to see a repeat of race one where the leader gets out in front and the whole field has to try to catch him in these closing laps? Now, they could probably do it if they weren't busy racing each other. Riley Durbin making it 3 wide for second place on Billy Bob Childers and Mark Thompson. Now, Billy Bob Childers came back to FARC along with teammate Jim Kidd. But so far, this is working out much better for Childers than Kidd. His engine is held together, and he's running up front in these late stages. Tiffany Birch and the 422 team have figured out what was going on with their car, and now Birch is running up in 13th place with 4 laps to go. She just got passed by Ashley Tucker. She hasn't quite had the pace as some of these leaders, but maybe she'll be able to hang on long enough to finish in a transfer spot. Now here's a guy looking to get back into a transfer spot. Art Gordon, car number 91 for Laser Motorsports. He fell back to 21st after that slide, fell behind on the restart, and he's struggling for speed. But in the meantime, last lap, the field has been trying to catch Kenny George. But it looks like they're not gonna have enough time. Max Chavillon, the 51, is inching closer and closer, but it's not gonna be enough. First start, first career victory for Kenny George III. Right in front of his home crowd. Once James West got in between George and second place, it was all over. The field just couldn't catch back up. But here's Leslie Riggs, the pole sitter, coming into the pits with a fire in the cockpit, coming to the checkered flag. She will bring that car to a stop, but not before crossing the line in 20th place. Fortunately, the Motor Assault team will not have to go to a backup car, and Riggs will keep her starting spot on the outside of the front row for the Smash Beer Get Smashed 200. Max Chavillon second, couldn't quite catch Kenny George the third. Third place, Jason Bates in the 09 for the James West team. Riley Durbin fourth, Mark Thompson fifth. Billy Bob Childers in his return to the series, sixth place. Zach Webster seventh, Kevin Monroe eighth, Kurt Walker ninth, and Dan Leglider rounds out the top 10, so both Leglider brothers will be racing in the Smash Beer 200. The Tuckers, Ashley and Thomas Tucker, will also both be competing in the 200. And that will make 3 pairs of siblings in tomorrow's race if you count the Riggs sisters. And who says this isn't a family sport? Billy Ray Smith Thompson and Bradley Carlisle, the Pearson Sweeney cars, with their new lineup, will be in tomorrow's race. Kelly Splicen, Tiffany Birch, Rebel Denman, Kyler Spavital, Art Gordon, all make it. Art Gordon picking up a couple of spots and getting himself into the race at the last moment. And now let's look at the point standings with one more race left to be run tomorrow. Richard Scott and Kenny George are tied for the lead with 115 points each. They are also the first drivers this season to earn FARC-off eligibility. Kenny George, we know, will be running the full season. We're not so sure what other plans Richard Scott has beyond Daytona. We've got another tie for 6th place between Liam O'Connor and Max Chavillon, who both finished 2nd in their races. Tie for 9th between Monica Rook and Mark Thompson. Robert Lecklider and Stanley Parsons are also tied for 17th. But tomorrow, these ties will be broken and more racing action will be had in the main event here at Daytona, the Smash Beer Get Smashed 200. Stay tuned, right here on the FARC Racing Network.